They insisted that it was possible to automatically detect copyright infringement. Now, this is quite an idea, and one that most computer scientists, again, find wildly improbable. Take a much easier to define and easier to solve domain problem, like finding and detecting spam. And one of my favorite things to do at technical conferences is say, who in this room has written a spam filter? And a bunch of hands go up, and I say, did any of them work? And all the hands go down. Spam is infinitely easier to detect than copyright infringement. It's all text. You can tell copyright infringement could literally be anything, since everything is copyrighted from the moment you fix it. If there's a picture of someone's kid's napkin doodle, that could be a copyright infringement too. And most importantly, the people who the spam filter is sitting upstream of want the spam filter to help them, whereas the people who are sitting downstream from the copyright filter don't want it to help. They're actively trying to foil you. We've never built a decent spam filter. Even the much vaunted PhD factory that is Google has never built an adequate spam filter. And the reason we've never built an adequate spam filter is because you would have to solve the hard artificial intelligence problem in order to do this. And if you did, you would have far more interesting things to do with your business than find spam or copyright infringement, like taking over the world. So we talk endlessly about the information economy and the information society. In 1999, we blithely enacted the WTO and watched every hard goods industry move to cheaper labor pools, and we assured ourselves that information jobs would replace the manufacturing jobs that were leaving our shores. And yet, we continue to treat the internet as a fitting political football in the bid to ensure windfall profits for the entertainment industry. So take, for example, the notion of three strikes. Depending on where you are, this is sometimes called graduated response. In France, it's called Hadopi. And at WIPO, when they first floated it, it was called notice and termination. This is a self-help measure, and what it says in one form or another is that if you are accused three times of infringing upon copyright, someone will come along and cut off your internet access. And so this has been a feature in proposals here in Canada, in the United States, internationally. Now, this is intended as a self-help measure, and we have other self-help measures in copyright enforcement. The most famous is something called notice and takedown. The idea was that if you host internet materials, web pages or what have you, your users might upload something that's infringing, a photograph, a game, a video, a song, and that you as the host, under the normal course of copyright law, might find yourself liable for that infringement. It depends. It's not really clear whether or not you would or wouldn't be prior to the notice and takedown regime. But what notice and takedown says is you are not liable for that infringement if you undertake to expeditiously remove anything that is infringing upon notice of the infringement. All right, so you are, the bargain goes like this. You've got a customer, the customer has a web page. A rights holder sends you an email. The email says, that web page infringes my copyright. Now, if you look at that web page and you say, there's no way that infringes anyone's copyright. It's a picture of my customer's kid. You have the choice of saying, go pound sand, doesn't infringe copyright. But if you're wrong and a lawsuit is brought, you can be held liable for damages in the United States of $150,000 civilly and $250,000 criminally for every act of infringement. Right? So this could really run into serious money, even these days when a million is more than a million. This is practically what this has done is meant that every ISP that receives one of these notices automatically takes the material down. Again, it's not worth asking a lawyer whether or not they should. The total profits that they're likely to receive from any given customer will be completely wiped out by the cost of asking a lawyer whether they should keep that person as a customer. And again, when we've done little tests, we've seen that this has happened. My favorite, there are some very mischievous people at the Oxford Internet Institute who put copies of John Stuart Mill's property on various web servers and then sent letters on behalf of John Stuart Mill to the hosting companies and found universally that they were willing to remove it. This is extremely open to abuse, in other words. But it's not just open to abuse, it's also open to sloppy exercise. So we have seen termination or takedown notices served, for example, on colleges that were unlucky enough to have a professor whose surname, Usher, was the same as a famous rock musician, and who put up his lectures with titles like Usher.mp3. The rights holder didn't bother to verify that this infringed their copyright. They kind of outsourced that verification, that externality, that cost, to the university network operators. And this is not an isolated incident. We find it again and again, these kinds of spurious takedown notices. We've also seen a lot of abuse. The Church of Scientology used notice and takedown routinely to attack its critics and to assert that in criticizing them and quoting their materials as part of that criticism, they infringed the Scientologists' copyright, and they used it to silence that debate. Likewise, another self-help measure, streamlined litigation, which isn't enshrined really in law, but has instead become part of practice, where rights holder organizations recruit third parties to sue en masse, ultimately tens of thousands of people, through a kind of boiler room operation in which you get a phone call that says, you're infringing our copyright, our client's copyright, for less than it will cost you to talk to a lawyer. We will clear you of that infringement. These people are paid in bulk. The more people they get settlements out of, the better. They're a little like a collection agency. And they've gone after such varied individuals as dead people, small children, people who don't own computers, and at one point, a sweet old grandmother who was accused of downloading a lot of gangster rap in Florida. This is my favorite. They accused a laser printer of downloading a copy of Indiana Jones. It's been capriciously exercised. We've seen Diebold, the voting machine company, use notice and takedown to try and silence people who had found and circulated an internal whistleblower memo asserting that Diebold knew and participated in what amounted to electoral fraud through its voting machines. We have a really awful example. There's a student at Swarthmore who maintained a free software project called Flatlan. Flatlan was a search engine. What it did is it crawled your LAN, hence Flatlan, your local area network, and found all the open file SharePoints and indexed them, the way that Google crawls the web, finds all the HTTP share, the web SharePoints, and indexes their contents. Now, on campuses, you often find PowerPoints of lectures, notes, old exams, MP3s of lectures, videos of lectures, student work, and so on. But of course, it being a campus, you also find lots of music, videos, games, and so on. To some nicety, every student on campus is a copyright infringer. I think everybody, to some nicety, is probably a copyright infringer. When I gave this talk at Disney, I said, is there anyone in this room who isn't a copyright infringer? And none of the lawyers put their hands up, but a couple of the engineers started to inch their hands up, not really sure whether what they did infringed on copyright or not. And the lawyers looked over and went, put your hand down. Now, this student, because he was a copyright infringer and because the potential liability went to the zillions, found himself in a very weak negotiating position. And when the record industry targeted him because the software that he used was used to infringe copyright, was used to find music on other campuses. Now, they knew that the software wasn't illegal and they would never successfully sue him for maintaining it, but they could successfully sue him for downloading music. Being an American teenager, he was guaranteed to be downloading music. And as part of the settlement, they demanded that he change majors, that he walk away from computer science and change majors. Now, he did, in fact, this did give him a little bit of negotiating power. That negotiating power was that this so outraged decency and common sense that when we publicized it through the Electronic Frontier Foundation, they were forced to rescind this demand. So self-help has historically been an invitation to vigilantism and an arrogation of the state's responsibility to due process. Yet, we're proposing to extend it beyond censoring publication. And we're proposing to extend it to access to the net itself. Think of what you do on the network. Think of that list that I just enumerated: your job, your health, your love, your family, your civic engagement, your creativity, even down to the trivial. In many places, the best or only way to stop your post when you go on holiday or to renew your magazine subscriptions is in using the network. All of this can be taken away without proof of wrongdoing on the mere assertion of infringement. Three strikes and you're out. And not only that, but it can be taken away from everyone in your household in a form of collective punishment that, again, justice historically has recoiled from. Justice has usually viewed the idea of punishing people who are near to someone who has broken some law as unjust. But in my household, we have 9 people who depend on our network connections. If one of us is accused 3 times of infringement, all 9 of us would lose our connection if 3 strikes became the law, and there is a proposal now in the UK to make it a law. And there's no reason to believe that this will stop or slow copying, because of course infringers, dedicated infringers, have access to cryptography through which they can prevent detection of their infringement. And moreover, they have access to hard drives, which are getting smaller and more capacious every day. When I taught through my Fulbright at the University of Southern California, I had a delightful group of undergraduates, and practically every one of them was a musician, and they loved to get together for jam sessions, a couple of cases of beer, some amps, some guitars, and some hard drives. And while they were playing, they would just synchronize terabytes of information. No matter what you do to the network, you won't stop hard drive parties. They're going to get faster and easier, not slower. So we're all copyists, and all of us become vulnerable, like that student at Swarthmore, to the capricious exercise of this self-help measure. To give you an idea of how unjust this is, imagine if it were reciprocal. Imagine if, when Universal Music filed 3 erroneous notice and termination notices, as they inevitably will, we went around to every Universal office in the world with a set of bolt cutters and disconnected them from the internet and made them the record label that ran on faxes from now on. Right? It would be a corporate death penalty, because taking a corporation out of the information society is ending a corporation. Taking an individual, a free person, out of the information society is really a form of exile in the 21st century. And there's no proportionality. Imagine if publishers were given letters of marque through which they could come to your house and take away your books if you were accused of being naughty with a photocopier 3 times. 3 strikes is being pushed on multiple fronts. In the US, Canada, Europe, and the other rich countries, it's being proposed through a secret treaty negotiation called ACTA, the Anti-Counterfeiting Trade Agreement. Now, I say it's a secret because the text of the treaty has not been released. There was a FOIA request, a Freedom of Information Act request, in the United States to the Obama regime, who denied it, saying that the text of this treaty was a matter of national security. But what we do know about this treaty, we've learned through leaks, because it's not a very good secret. In the US, the Trade Department has a list of some 300 or 400 advisors, including executives from breweries, fertilizer executives, paint executives, and so on, who are all allowed to look at this treaty. And they've leaked it like a sieve. So we've seen various drafts of it. The Obama administration released memos about it and so on. And we know that it includes a 3 strikes regime. We know that it also includes a duty for border police to police copyright on hard drives, to start to check data as it crosses borders and on physical containers to see whether it infringes. And when this first came to light, people on my side of this fight said, well, this means they're going to have to start searching your iPods. And the memo that the Obama administration released about it, saying, no, you don't need to worry, they said, well, it won't involve searching iPods, because anything that is not that wouldn't allow a substantial act of infringement will be exempt. Well, I don't know about you, but I expect my iPod to hold every song ever recorded in about 5 years. That's the trajectory solid-state storage is on. I don't know how you could consider any of the data devices that we carry around to be less than significant. I mean, certainly the Christmas ornament I was given last year as a premium at a grocery store, which held about 200 songs, and which was so cheap it could essentially be given away free like a Happy Meal toy, qualifies as capable of a substantial act of infringement. I could definitely put about 3,000 or 4,000 books on it.